The first session is the topic of investing in our sheep and wool industries. Firstly, we'll hear from James Robertson, who is a 2011 scholar from New South Wales. James, if you'd like to come up, please.
It's always wonderful to be first up on a session like this. Thank you very much for whoever organised that. It's a great pleasure to be here. My study topic is early weaning using a high starch diet to influence rumen development. And I was able to pursue this study with the wonderful support of AWI, Ian Evans and Claudia Wilds. I think Claudia's here somewhere. There she is up the back. Thank you very much, Claudia. May AWI keep sponsoring Nuffield Scholars, because the opportunity that's given me has been fantastic. Okay. Also, thanks to Nuffield, but I'll do some more thank yous later. Is that too loud? Is that better? I'll thank in particular to Jim and Terry, and also Andrew Johnson, who really promoted me being involved with Nuffield, and of course to Nicola, who put so much effort into these days. Thank you very much. Okay, I'm from a property in South Australia, but we also have some country in New South Wales. It consists of four properties in the semi-arid rangeland environment. It's about 126,000 hectares, 212 mils of rain a year, poor quality native pastures, all in all, it's a pretty rough block. We have three main enterprises there. One is harvesting feral goats that come in from the surrounding national parks. That's how marginal it is, because most of the country around us in South Australia has got a national park because it hasn't been profitable. But last year we trucked out 22,000 goats in 18 months, which helped sponsor my Nuffield program just as much as AWI. We also have an intensive feedlot system where we try and value add our merino sheep, because of our poor quality pastures and our reliance on a fairly inconsistent and low rainfall, we're not always able to finish them as we'd like. And of course, the mainstay of our operation is our wool enterprise. We sell about 400 bales of premium quality 21 micron rangeland wool every year, just the sort of thing that goes in the Hessian undies, I think. not quite. It sounds a bit better than that. My study topic, early weaning using a high starch diet. Why did I choose it? Well, because we weren't getting the lamb percentage that we wanted. We were getting about 70%. District average is about that, but we weren't making any money. I'm sure no one else was. We needed to do better. And when we weaned, given that we had a run of poor seasons, the weaners didn't do particularly well for about 3 or 4 months. And just about every bit of literature you read about weaning is, if you don't have your lambs on a rising planar condition, you're susceptible to high losses. And we achieved that as well. So ultimately, what that means is that you're not going to make too much money, and your profits will be poor. So I felt I had to make some changes to our business. And when we looked at it, what did we want to do? Well, we really wanted to reduce our post-weaning losses, improve our post-weaning weight gain. That was critical. And as a part of that, we wanted to improve performance of the adult sheep. More wool, more meat, more lambs, less feed, more profit. It was pretty simple. How do we go about it? We changed our weaning system. And weaning is not just taking the lamb away from its mum. It is changing from a milk diet to a solid-based diet. An undeveloped rumen to a fully functional, developed rumen that can make use of solid feed, turn that into usable energy. How do we go about it? Well, we bit the bullet and made a bold decision, and I'll probably never make a decision that bold again, but we put our entire lamb drop in 50 by 40 metre pens and introduced a high starch diet in the form of grain concentrates for a 21-day period to artificially influence that rumen beyond what would occur in a natural environment. And the objective of that was, when we released them from the pens after 21 days, they would be able to utilise our poor quality native pasture and go like bolters. little picture on the right, it's a bit hard to see, it's the inside of a Roman, a developed Roman after our project. In a normal undeveloped Roman that a land would have when it's being weaned, it's more like the inside of the Roman is more like the outside of a basketball. The papillae length on the Roman there is about 5 to 6 millimetres, increases the surface area dramatically, and therefore it can be more efficiently gain energy from the pasture. So I travelled to New Zealand, the UK and the US, and some of you might sort of ask, you know, what's the pastoral range and producer going to get from going to all these intensive sheep industry locations? I must admit I thought about that too, but I got some great stuff from it. But the first trip I did was to New Zealand, and I found that they were having similar problems to me in terms of my weaning. I went to a property called Awapai in Hawke's Bay, and just out of Hawke's Bay in New Zealand. It's a big operation, 1,200 hectares, 197 paddocks, and they've got like opening gates. They were running about 30,000 DSC on this 1,200 hectares. And it was a really professional, high-standard operation, and they measured everything, which is why I wanted to go there. They attempted or introduced a high-starch diet to their weaning system, and had some terrific interim results. They did slightly differently to me, in that they did it in a small paddock. I guess, well, from my point of view, all paddocks are small in New Zealand. Mine are about 10,000 acres. So they introduced about 250 grams a day of a pellet and concentrate feed, and also they had a control model. What it demonstrated was in the presence of a high starch concentrate additive, because it's not a replacement, it's just an additive to try and get them to utilise paddock feed better, and they achieved a 30% increase in growth rate. And that's an increase in growth rate of 380 grams per day in the fed mob over the control mob. But after the 21-day weaning period with the starch, both mobs were joined and running paddocks without the presence of the concentrate. And unfortunately, after 100 days, both groups had the same growth rates. So they maintained their difference in weight, but after 100 days, that rumen function was the same in both mobs without the presence of starch. And this was a real kick in the guts for me, because I was going to New Zealand and these other places to validate the theory that I could permanently influence rumen function. It was terribly disappointing. But it was a great learning experience. So I jumped on a plane and went to Devon in the south of England, and was really lucky enough to meet a guy called David Merrin, who's an Irish expat. His business is purely and only taking the bobby calves that are surplus from dairies and feeding them to about 550-600 kilos. So he's purchasing them in at 50 kilos, putting them on milk replacement, and gradually introducing a high starch concentrate to their feed mix. And when they reach 100 kilos, he rears them for the next period in the paddock, maintaining that delivery of high starch concentrate diet so that they can make better use of the feed in the paddock. And this was starting to, this message was starting to come through to me, and say, well, okay, we might have to maintain that delivery of starch to get the results we're looking for. His key message was, without starch, he cannot operate his business. He's selling 1,000 beef cattle, well, the dairy genetics, but beef cattle in the end, on 500 acres. David Rossiter down the road in Devon also has introduced a lot of genetic improvement to his flock. Incidentally, he was an ex-dairy farmer who got wiped out with TB and went into sheep. He won Farmer of the Year in 2008, I think, in the UK, because of the way he dealt with his and the TB issue and how he restructured his business. But he introduced Myomax gene. It's an improvement in muscling. Two copies gives you a 10% improvement in carcass muscling. It's roughly $4.25 per lamb increase in value. But he can't get that, he can't express that genetic potential of the sheep unless he subsidises or assists rumen function in that lamb with some starch. And his key message was he needed to give them a little bit of starch so they get everything out of the paddock to express their genetic potential. This was all great, but I was looking for a model as to how I could deliver a more cost-effective concentrate diet to my weaners, how I could achieve the results at home. John Scott, I think in 2006, Nuffield scholar from Scotland in the Tarbuck Peninsula, had a really, really good system that he employed. Using creek feeders, which are feeders with a gate on the front to allow only the lambs to get through, not the adult sheep. And he had business stresses or physical stresses on the farm that meant that he only had a short peak growing season where he had great value feed in the paddock. Scotland is a tough environment. A bit different to the tough environment at home, but it has its own stresses nevertheless. So they only get 12 to 14 weeks of high value feed and then it goes rank. So he realised in his business he needed to get his lambs up and cracking a little bit earlier in order to utilise that better feed. So he introduced creek feeds with a high starch concentrate diet, and at 12 weeks of age he would sell his first tranche of lambs at 40 to 45 kilograms in weight, and at which point he would wean the balance. But he would not just remove the lambs from the ewes, he made sure the lambs remained in the same paddock with their familiar surroundings and the feeder. And what he found was that the lambs would get a small amount of stress, so they go and comfort feed at their feeder, and the 4 weeks between them and his first two sales, the lambs put on the most weight during their growing cycle of any period. And he was achieving results in excess of 700 grams a day, which I thought was all right. And so, I guess really, you know, we sort of get into the summary part. And can rumen function be manipulated by the introduction of a high starch diet? Well, I think it can. I find that it can. Is it permanent? I don't know. And I suspect that some of the research indicates that unless weaning occurs prior to 8 weeks of age in lambs, it may not be possible. It's contrary to some of the advice I received early on in my weaning and when I was introducing my weaning protocols. My study abroad has changed my view somewhat on that, but I think there's still some excellent room for manoeuvring, or excellent room for more study and more application of this sort of project. What are the benefits? Well, even though that introduction may not be permanent, I'm getting better weight gain in my young sheep because they're hitting the paddock running. And the difference is 10 to 15 kilos at the end of that 16 months. May not be permanent, but I think we all appreciate that if you've got a thriving ewe hogget, then it's far more likely to be more productive in its future rather than a struggling ewe hogget. What have I changed in my business? Well, obviously I introduced the pen weaning. What am I going to change? I'll probably go to a creek feeding system in the paddock. A lot easier because hell, it's hard. You know, when I introduced the pen weaning, I'd never hand fed a sheep in my life. In fact, none of my sheep had ever been fed. I knew nothing about it. And I put my entire lamb drop into bloody pens. If I knew the risk of doing that, I would never have done it. But fortunately, we sort of succeeded a little bit. So what am I going to change? Well, obviously, we're going to put creek feeders in our lambing paddocks. Recommendations for the industry. I think there's a real opportunity to identify some weaning protocols that will improve productivity of farms and reduce weaning losses in the future. And I think that's something that AWI and MIA can help work together on. There's already projects done, but I think it can be built upon. Use of starch, well, I obviously clearly think it can improve the feed conversion efficiency, which is the overarching objective. Creep feeding seems to work well in a cost-effective manner, and obviously early weaning in a broad sense improves opportunities for ewes to improve in condition prior to the next joining. range land producers essentially have been doing the same thing for the last 150 years. Sheep grow wool, sell them for meat, and just got to shear them every year, and they have a few lambs. You know, and not a lot's changed. We've changed from horses to Toyotas and that sort of thing, but I think the next generation of young farmers has the opportunity to maximise the genetic improvement in the flock and achieve rewards by making changes like this. One of the changes we did make was that because we're close to a citrus growing area, and we make use of a little bit of starch that citrus have, and we've the last 9 months we've had about 1,300 tonnes. I didn't really think it was going, I didn't know how well it was going to work, but one day I was driving along the paddock through the Mallee, about 5 k's away from where a pile of citrus had been dumped, and there's two sheep walking along with oranges in their mouth. I thought, yep, they're on it. Fantastic. thank you very much to everyone that's supported me in my study and the application of that. It's been a wonderful experience. Thank you very much to AWI. I would never have had the opportunity to do what I've done without our grower body. I can't express enough my gratitude there. Nuffield Australia, Jim, Terry, Jono, all the crew, the GFP group. Sometimes I wasn't thanking them in the morning, but we had a great trip around the world together. New friends and hosts I met, obviously Kerry and the girls, they sacrificed a bit more than most during my trips for a whole range of reasons, but thank you very much. Phil and Sue Dark, great friends of mine that I met. He's a 2011 Nuffield Scholar from the UK, met in New Zealand, stayed for a length of time in Devon when I was over there. I was texting him back and forth during the test. He was giving me a hard time. And unfortunately, a couple of days after that, he had a heart attack and died. Nuffield has lost a great guy. Phil, thank you very much.